Okay, that sounds good now, sir. Okay.
Good morning, everybody. Today's guest lecture is of Dr. Jagdish Rane. I would like to request Dr. Pawan Kulwal, sir, to introduce about the guest.
Okay, good morning, everybody. So, on behalf of CAST project on climate smart agriculture water management, I welcome you all. So, on behalf of all the participants, I wish you good morning. So, there is no need for everybody to write again good morning in the chat box. Otherwise, you will miss important messages. So, since we already have circulated the brief bio of Dr. Jagdish Rane to all the participants, but still I would like to mention few points about him. Yesterday, we listened to the excellent lectures on genomics, but genomics is incomplete without the proper phenotyping, and phenomics is very important aspect in recent years. And it has also gained very important aspect in any breeding or any agriculture related subject. So considering his vast experience, we have invited Dr. Jagdish Rane. Sir, good morning to you, and thank you very much for sparing your valuable time. For the information of participant, Dr. Rane is still stuck up in Pune because of the lockdown, and he could not visit his office, but he has agreed to deliver this lecture from Pune. So we must thank him profusely for sparing his time. Dr. Rane is the principal scientist and head of the division of School of Drought Stress Management at ICR, National Institute for Abiotic Stress Management, Baramati. And since January 2012, he is leading a multidisciplinary team for management of drought stress and abiotic stresses at Baramati. And he has vast experience, over 2 decades of experience working in stress, abiotic stress physiology. And he has also been instrumental in establishing the plant phenotyping or plant phenomics facility at International Center for Tropical Agriculture, Colombia, which is CGIAR Institute, as well as at DWR, Directorate of Wheat Research, now IIWBR, Karnal, as well as he has also established a phenomics, excellent phenomics facility at Baramati. And his significant works include identification of the, actually he has demonstrated, and he and his team has demonstrated root system architecture, which improves the drought avoidance. And they have also cloned and characterized BRO1, which is an important gene in for drought resistance in rice. And that article was published in Nature Genetics. So that is a very great amount of work he has done. His areas of interest are plant stress physiology, plant phenomics, and drought stress management in particular. And he has also traveled across the different continents, including America, Europe, Africa, Asia, and Australia. He is also a member of several societies, including Crop Science Society of America, Indian National Science Congress, and Indian Society of Plant Physiology. He is also the member of executive board of expert working group for adaptation of wheat to abiotic stress and wheat phenotyping, member of institutional management committee, as well as board of studies of different agriculture universities or different institutes in India, and also editor of several journals, including international journals. And he has also received several awards, including the gold medal for his MSc at US Harvard. And he has also earned his PhD in plant physiology from IIRA, New Delhi. So thank you very much, sir, for sparing your valuable time in guiding us on the important aspect of plant phenomics. So with this, I request Dr. Jagdish Rane, sir, to start his presentation. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Pawan. Good morning to you all. I'll start with the topic given to me. It is plant phenomics expectations, progress, and opportunities to deliver products for abiotic stress. So, the brief outline is, I will start with some simple definition of phenomics. Many of you may be knowing, and a lot of literature is not available, and how the plant phenomics has progressed for the last one decade, how the imaging tools have emerged, and how phenotyping platforms have emerged, and what exactly they are doing. Then I will shift to the initiative at NIAS, and then opportunities and the future outlook, what we are going to do. So if you look into the plant phenomics, I can say this is an evolving science. To put it in a simple way, it is a science and action for quantifying plant responses to external stimuli in a way that the data generated can help in precise identification of genes responsible for those functions with greater power of prediction derived from large set of genotypes screened. Here, the plant phenomics is characterizing the plants, but in a large scale. That's what, to bridge the gap between the phenotype and genotype. So if you look into the expectations and predictions which were there in 2011, almost 9 years ago, so it was said that the plant phenomics will offer a suite of new technologies to accelerate progress in understanding gene function and environmental responses, and it will enable breeders to develop new agricultural germplasm to support future agriculture production. And all, if you can refer to the Robert et al. In 2011 in functional plant phenomics. Then the imaging system for high throughput phenotyping that evolved basically with the understanding that whatever the signals in different wavelength, band wavelength in the electromagnetic spectrum can reveal lot many things in addition to what a breeder's eye can tell. These image-based technologies in different wavelength of electromagnetic spectrum and automation together can accelerate the plant phenotyping or characterizing the plant and can provide sufficient phenotypic data for plant breeders and molecular biologists to identify the genes. That was the hypothesis. And these are the imaging technologies which were there at that time in mind. Color images for plant area, volume, mass and all. I will not read everything. Just the idea is to give you a brief account of what exactly happened since 2011. Senescence seed yield, then near infrared imaging for tissue water content, soil water content, grain quality, stem carbohydrates, infrared imaging for surface temperature, fluorescence for imaging and X-ray technology, NMR technology and lot many other things. So if you look into the development since 1998 onwards, if you start the concept of phenotype evolved in 1911, it is said, then Belgium crop design, it was the first private firm to bring in high throughput technology based on the image and automation. And then it was followed up by German labs and also Australian plant phenomics facility. Then European plant phenotyping network came up with the support of the European fund. And then there was international plant phenomics network, national and regional plant phenotyping networks. They came somewhere in 2015-16. And then now we are talking about multi-scale phenomics, big data, artificial intelligence to handle that huge set of data and to come out with novel phenotype. So in India, four high throughput phenotyping facility were created in between 2016 and 2017. ICRISAT has a very nice facility for phenotyping for water use efficiency. Then US Bangalore has come out with its own system, that is the indigenous system. So what could be demonstrated with phenomics tools? So by visible light imaging, visible light camera, gray color value images, whole organs or organ parts, time series, how they are developing, then morphological traits, lot many. Then fluorescence imaging, those cameras are being used for photosynthetic status or quantum yield of the plant. It tells about the plant health under stress condition. Those technologies are now available. Then thermal imaging, it is now very popular. So it is used for surface temperature, indirectly the canopy and leaf water status, seed composition, particularly NIR1, leaf and canopy transpiration, then heat dissipations, stomatal conductance differences. These are the phenotypes. Then near infrared cameras, particularly for the tissue water content. And then spectral imaging with hyperspectral radiometer and hyperspectral cameras. Now it has become very common. What exactly it does, continuous or discrete spectra it gives for each of the genotype and at a given moment. Water content and seed composition, indoor time series experiment have been employed in generating generating information about morphology structure, color parameter, that's senescence, shoot structures and all. Then laser scanning for depth maps, plant organ morphology, shooter structure, leaf angle. So I was talking before this one, the 3D imaging, then the time of flight cameras and all, laser scanning cameras, then MRI, magnetic resonance images for root studies, PET position and position emission detectors for actual movement of the metabolites inside the plant, and then CTX tomography for both like tissue density till then even root scanning, and this is at the microscopic level also for the phenotyping. It has been used, and CT tomography has been clearly demonstrated for root phenotyping in a medium throughput way. BASF and Monsanto, they are working together to screen a large number of genotypes and identify the genes. Then the scan analyzer, it became most popular because of their commercial approach. And to the best of my knowledge, in the world, there are more than something like 15 to 16 LemmaTech facilities throughout the world. And in India, we have 4, and National Institute of Arbitrary Stress Management is one of them. They are like, they have RGB cameras, then fluorescence cameras, infrared, near infrared cameras, but sensor itself will move. That type of facilities are also available. Then they are also again phenotyping for plant geometry growth. So there is one more platform like established by KeyGene, digital phenotyping. And then there are many others like PhenoFab. This is using PhenoFab RGB sensors. Then corn phenotyping they started with. So I was talking about the scan analyzer, and more than 15 places this platform has been established. And in India, there are 4 LemmaTech plant phenomics platforms. And the sensors to plant type of platforms are available in Germany. And then KeyGene digital for platform, this is one which is used for phenotyping horticulture crops, even including the tomato and all. Then there are many others like PhenoFlex. It's very important to mention about it because it's a joint work of and the ICRISAT, PhenoSpex, with the 3D laser instruments, multispectral camera and all are being used even at ICRISAT. And this can also doubt spotting. That's something like doubt spotter automated gravimetric sensors are also available with it. Then the mobile device, that's the plant eye, is used in this one. Then there are many others like Phenopsis, Screenhouse, and Rice Automatic Plant Phenotyping System. Then water is efficient platform where each of the pot in the what you call screenhouse is loaded with provided with the lysimeter, and they are all connected, and regularly water use efficiency is measured there. So now when we talk about field phenotyping, there are ground based and UAV based field phenotypings are available. In ground-based one, we talk about field scan analyzer, field scan, plant screen field systems. Much of them are dominated by the Australian plant phenotyping group as well as German plant phenotyping group. Then the other way is going for the unmanned aerial vehicles, so what we call as drones, loaded with different sensors, cameras and all. They are also being used for the field phenotyping. Then there are some other phenotyping tools like root laser ablation tomography, laser dissection microscope tomography, phenotyping, lot many instruments, lot many methodologies have been standardized. And then this is again the same. Then micro CT images, they are being used to phenotype the anatomy of the plants, particularly stalk or the roots and all those things. And to put it in a brief way, there are plant phenotypic tools for canopy, whole plant, organ, tissue, and cell. When we talk about canopy at whole plant, we are trying to interpret at a whole plant level interception of the light and even canopy temperature and also at the whole, that's at canopy level, whole plant, that plant volume, biomass without touching the plants and all, even the yield, seed yield, pod number and all. Then organs, like how the grains are stuffed in, how, what is the distributions and all. Then tissue, how like the anatomy is, what is the location of any particular substance that we are looking for, and at cellular level. So what we are like looking into the genotypic space and also the external environment and external phenotypes. And then we are trying to be the, actually it is the internal phenotype which decides external phenotype, that's morphology and performance in field condition in terms of yield and all. But what like more easy nowadays is to look into these external phenotypes with so many methods. Then in addition to that, when we talk about plant phenomics, we also generate huge set of environmental data. So under controlled environment, water consumption, nutrient consumption, and all other weather parameters regularly recorded, they will be all co-variables when we analyze the phenomic data for interpretation of the plant responses to stresses and all. And same applies for the field, soil moisture dynamics, soil temperature, weather parameters. There are set up with so many sensors which can tweet the temperature, relative humidity into mobile every minute. That much huge set of data is being generated. So now other parallel activity, if you look into, which are going on to handle this huge set of data, phenotypic data standardization and storage. I don't want to read. Then model assisted phenotyping. So with this huge set of data, can we come up with some models which are really smart or resistant or resilient to the stress conditions or stress environment? That is also being worked out. Then if you look into the status now in 2020, what we are talking about the crop phenomics is, it is integrating now agronomy, life sciences, information sciences, math and engineering sciences. It is combining high performance computing and artificial intelligence technology. It is yet to come to explore multifarious phenotypic information. Then aiming at effective technical systems to enable phenotype of crop in a high throughput, that large number of genotypes, multidimensional, that's organ, whole plant level and all, then big data and also on. So then opportunities for us now, it is really possible to make the job easy when we ask the question, how plant responds to abiotic stresses. So many things, so much data we can generate with all these tools. How plant responds to bioregulators, if we are applying any other substances to improve abiotic stress tolerance, yes, a large set of these formulations can also be evaluated on the other side. We derive our interpretation based on root architecture phenotyping, and also physiology of the plants. For example, water relations of plant tissues, transpiration, leaf senescence, plasticity of root or shoot in presence of water or in absence of water and so on. So at National Institute of Abiotic Stress Management, that's my institute, which is a unique and recently established, we talk about abiotic stresses related to water, soil, and atmosphere. And we are exploring opportunities to accelerate genomics-aided crop improvement for abiotic stresses. So we talk about soil moisture deficit. We are also talking about alkalinity, salinity, water logging, crop logging. We have not yet started. Nutrients excess or deficit, that also we have to start. So we want to look into the plant responses and possible genes, traits and all, taking into consideration the abiotic stresses in present form or in amplified version due to climate change in future. So how we are going to deal with it, this some of the chapters explain from this book, Abiotic Stress Management, explains that one. We are trying to embed these opportunities in our research framework, where we talk about the research target delineation, adaptation and mitigation. we are focusing here in genetic improvement, and we are bringing in this phenomics and genomics concept. So we talk about climate smart phenotype, where we talk that its effect on effect of environment on it, optimum or non-optimum, natural or managed conditions, and the genes responsible for it. So we have to translate those science into performance. So we have to we are trying to define the climate smart varieties as those which can perform when nature or farmer give optimum input, and if there are no optimum input, suboptimal, then also it has to survive and leave something in a way that it should benefit the next crop. So we are talking about editing or stacking genes, that are molecular aided selections, CRISPR-Cas and all. So agronomically superior genotypes, structural stability, developmental and functional genes that we are talking about, that's our target for improving. And that when we talk about traits, then both conventional route and genomic route that we are keeping in mind, and both the routes should be helped by plant phenomics tools for crop improvement. And ultimately, when we talk about phenomics, it is synonym that we have to screen large number of genotypes. And when we do that one, when we hunt for the traits by using the plant phenomics, we keep some mechanisms as base for drought tolerance traits. For example, drought, like abiotic stress tolerance, here the case of drought. Drought coping is mainly due to escape or dehydration avoidance or dehydration tolerance. That's the basic thing that we have learned. When you talk about seasonal escape, all the time plant breeders, they talk about the genotypes of short duration. They escape the terminal heat stress or terminal drought stress and all. But we also should talk about the diurnal escape, where we talk about plants' capacity to escape from high temperature or the demand for high transmissional demand. It has to adjust its thermostatic mechanism. So they are all diurnal escape. So how to phenotype them? That's the point. Now we know that canopy temperature can help us in IR imaging can help us in understanding the canopy temperature, and it is possible to screen large number of genotypes. Even within half an hour, you can tell which genotype is keeping its canopy cooler. So that one we applied in our screening experiments, and we screened large number of soybean genotypes, and we could identify those genotypes which are yielding high because of low temperature, low canopy temperature, and some genotypes they were capable of yielding high despite high temperature. That means there are two mechanisms are operating there. And then in case of what we call diurnal escape, I don't want to talk much about that seasonal escape, how we can do that one. So continuously monitor the plant response in presence and in absence of water. And then we can search for genotypes which clothe their stomata rapidly at 2 p.m. when the temperatures are very high, when transpiration demand is very high, and then we can look into what are the genes responsible for that one. So we use these phenotyping tools, particularly thermal imaging system, to differentiate response of the plant to Bradyrhizobium strains. And what we have to do is, like, we have to prefer adaptive traits over the performance traits. So what those adaptive traits are: reducing leaf area to reduce the transpiration, leaf rolling, leaf drying, they're all common features. They're all adaptive traits. Then dehydration avoidance also we are talking about, stomatal closure, dynamics and root system architecture and so on. What I am trying to emphasize here, is there possibility to look into the true tolerance, not escapers. So those genotypes which can maintain their photosynthesis even under desiccated conditions. Can we identify some of the genotypes which can keep their leaf green even for a longer time? Those things we have to look into. Let us take photosynthesis even under desiccated condition. Is it possible? So we know that NIR imaging system can help us in looking into the water relations, water content of the tissue. that we optimize and very clearly shown that it is possible to look into the variation between the genotypes for water content. And these are the some of the experiments that we did. And we got very clear differences at particular stage of crop that also we identified for pigeon pea, chickpea, and also for mung bean. And on other side, we have chlorophyll fluorescence imaging system where we can look into the health of photosystem too. If you combine, we can keep it type, we have to go for, and this is not easy for breeder's eye. We can employ PhilMix tools. Then let us take up some of the features of smart crop. For example, smart crop rapidly cover ground to reduce evaporative loss. Can we identify them by employing plant phenomics tools? So it is possible to regularly monitor how plant or leaf are expanding and how the canopy is expanding, how canopy is covering its ground. So we can choose the genotype which are like we can phenotype for this particular trait that ground covering capacity and related to the genes. Then we have also demonstrated that like top view of the email the plants grown in pots, they can also explain the fresh biomass, and that can be used to monitor biomass accumulation throughout the plant growth or before and after the stress is imposed. And this is what like we observed in case of chickpea when well watered and water stress. This type of tools clearly differentiate stress and normal condition, and also the genotypes all genotypes under control and drought condition. Then other features, smart crop senesce slowly even under stress condition. That is the stay green trait. How to identify? It is possible to look into the RGB pixels and see the variation among the genotypes. So we like looked into the RGB pixels and actual chlorophyll values, and we saw that there's a quite good correlation, but in some cases it won't, because other features of the plants, they influence this relation. Then smart crop rapidly recover from stress, how to identify them? And if you look into this video, I often show this in my presentation. These are the soybean genotypes, totally allowed to dry, and then we put the water at a time. One genotype is recovering very fast, other one very slow. Can we look into this type of genotype? Because we know that in future, the frequency of water will be frequency of rains will be less, and the intensity will be very high, and there will be long dry spells. So we want the plants which can recover when they'll be they get water through the rain or protective irrigation. Then how to phenotype large number of plants for these type of traits? When we talk about that, we have a large set of traits given by the plant phenotyping tools. That is the image traits. We talk about boundary layer, then convex hull and density, circumferences, so many other parameters. For example, you can look into the different genotypes here, that pigeon pea, and the shape of them under drought stress condition. How to monitor the changes in the shape? That is possible. Here it is a convex hull area. So I really don't want to explain this one at this point. It will take a long time. So this explains the feature, that the one which you have seen in previous slide. And this is the image is converted into the data, and this is the variation we observe after imposing the stress in case of pigeon pea genotype. What I want to say, that these tools, these data can differentiate the response of the plant with respect to shoot architecture. So many of these traits together determine the plant biomass. So what all parameters can be prioritized for predicting the biomass of the plant and using that prediction for monitoring the growth throughout the plant crop season? So we employed some of the machine vision algorithm to prioritize some of the traits and derive a formula for prediction of biomass, and we use them for differentiating the genotypes. And then there is another parameter in between, just that's the compactness. If you look into compactness of the plant, this is the difference between the control and drought. And we, when we screen the genotypes for this particular trait, we get large like variation, and this variation can be assessed in context of tolerance to drought that we have to work it out. And we can use NR intensity again to look into the status of water content in tissues right in the field or in the pot grown plants. And we got quite a good variation, and we also got some of the genotypes better than the local genotypes of chickpea, that is the Jigvijay. And when we talk about so many parameters, and when we do the correlation among these genotypes, these parameters, through something like 20-23 days, we observe the correlation between these parameters vary. They might be indicating some trait. What are those traits? Can we phenotype for that trait? And can we like look into the genes associated with trait that we have to look into? Excite leaf water loss, that's another trait that we want to measure, phenotype in high throughput mode by using NIR. That also we optimize. And chlorophyll fluorescence imaging system to look into the photosystem II efficiency. Lot many parameters are available that we can look into, and we can relate it to the tolerance or resistance of the plant to the abiotic stresses like drought. Then we can combine conventional traits in high throughput mode. That attempt we are making in plant phenomics facility that we have. There are three major tasks: image unit configuration, then image analysis configuration, and data acquisition and interference. These are the three steps that we have to optimize. Image unit configuration, we optimize for many of the crops, pulse crops, and other crops also, soybean, maize, rice, and sunflower. Image analysis configurations also we have made. It is like we have to still go, we have to go a long way. Then data acquisition and inference, that is a huge set of data that we have. We are now coming out with some methods to handle that one and to interpret the traits and come out with a new trait, novel traits, which can explain tolerance of plants to abiotic stresses like drought. Then we also looked into the low-cost tools. I showed one which we can move in the field, and there is another one like with question like, is it possible to look into the pollen germination or pollen traits right in the field condition? Can we carry a microscope in the field? So we use the foldscope. Many of you must be knowing that one. Our objective was to optimize the method for looking into the pollens and the variation, how it responds to rise in temperature and all that we have optimized. And we also like looked into the pollen tube growth with that small mini microscopes. Maybe some of these techniques, if like optimized further, can be useful in at least medium throughput phenotyping of pollen traits. Then beyond biomass and root, like we are also talking about the root phenotyping, and we developed some method to look into the root growth regularly to monitor root growth. This is the rice, but still like we had to further optimize this method. And then we are talking about the grain component, grain yield components. For example, genetic variation in grain size, how the grain, the spike morphology is varying, how the distribution of assimilates are varying from genotype to genotype, how we can quantify that one. Are there any tools that we wanted to work out? And we optimized some of the methods, and we measured length and width and other features of the each of the grain of spikes by using imaging tools, and we correlated with the actual one, and we got quite a good correlation. And we are putting all these efforts and all these tools in a concept called Imaging Scientific Hints About Resilience to Abiotic Stresses, ISHARAS, which necessarily includes image capture methods standardization, image analysis method standardization, then database and inference methods, method development that we are involved in. And we have seen that focusing on only one trait like root angle, how we can make a genotype like a drought intolerant cultivar, that is IR64, into a drought tolerant cultivar. It was focused on only one particular trait which can be easily seen. But there are many tools, many traits which are not visible to the bare eye, but the phenomics tools can reveal that one, that we can look into. Yesterday there was a nice talk by Dr. Roy, where he also used to phenotype the grains for amylose content, resistant amylose and all. And we can, if it has to be done, similar type of work has to be done, it's based on the color, we can use some of the phenotypic tools to screen large number of genotypes and identify the actual gene or positional cloning, what you people call in genomics. Then challenges to be addressed. Whatever the plant phenomics tools that we have, they are all focused on structural phenotypes. So image-based plant phenotypes, they tell about some linear, they are linear function about shoot area, NDVI, and all those things. And also non-linear, like geometric statistics, that height, convex cells, then center of mass, so many other parameters. And when we talk about biotic and abiotic stresses, they are very tricky, very critical. There are no really like, this is the method we have to follow. It has not been like finalized. I have not seen. What we are like able to do here is external phenotype. We can easily identify, quantify, and generate phenotypic data. But these external phenotypes are mainly due to the internal phenotype. And internal phenotype, there's functions and processes are due to genes and gene network. But now we have to relate external phenotype to genes and gene network, and lot of statistics and computer skills we have to use, and that is now going to dominate. And ultimate objective of all these exercise will be to design crops for each of the stress situation. Say, look into this one, drought. If you say that drought in deep soil, it is different. Drought in shallow soil, it is different. Drought in presence of high temperature, drought in presence of absence of high temperature, everything is different. We have to design a crop for each of these situation. And we have to get those traits incorporated in the farmer's variety. And there are opportunities to do that through the multidisciplinary approach. Crop physiology, mechanical engineer, software engineer, data scientist, plant breeder, molecular biologist. Then whole team effort that can work. And we can look into the large set of germplasm that are available in gene banks. And we can look into the genotypes which are really tolerant, that I told you, the genotype which can keep their photosynthesis intact even after 50% desiccation, that can be searched for, and then we can hope for that molecular, that genomics approach for crop improvement. In summary, smart crop with tolerance to stresses and recovery capacity is essential, and some of the features can be like phenotype, and novel phenotypic traits can be evolved. Then lot many plant phenomics opportunities are there. But a big challenge would be huge set of machine-generated data. That quality check, analysis, and interpretation is very much essential. Now we are talking about artificial intelligence and all. That will be another intervention in plant phenotyping. Then multidisciplinary approach is really very much essential. That's what I wanted to tell. And my thanks to all my teammates. And MPKV Rahuri, particularly Dr. Pawan Kulwal, for giving me the opportunity. Nikrak Rida is supporting this plant phenomics work at National Institute of Probiotic Stress Management. Then EWG, expert work group, phenotyping beat. I get a lot of information, current information. My colleague at Indian Institute of Wheat and Barley Research, where I started phenotyping, then International Center for Tropical Agriculture, then my present institute, ICR NIAS, and my director and all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Participants are asking some questions in chat box.
Okay.
One of the question is whether it is possible to use these type of phenotyping platforms for sugarcane or like horticultural crops.
Yes. So there are two ways, like looking into this one. If you are going to phenotype them under field condition, now we have a platform that are drone, UAV platforms, DOE platforms and all. And as I have shown, some of the machines loaded with the sensors, that's camera, can be moved into the orchards, and we can look into those response of the horticulture plants. Vegetables, that is same as any of the annual field crops, we can employ them. And sugarcane, yes, we are planning to do at least some part of it at the seedling stage. We can do that one. If you want to do it under field condition, again we have to go for the mobile system loaded with the cameras, or we can do that one.
Thank you, sir. One more question from participants. What are the different databases available for the phenotyping?
Yes, there are a couple of databases are available. I want to refer you to one of the references latest published in 2019 by Zhang et al. So please go through it. That is published in Conscious in Plant Science. You can just remember Zhang et al. So I will take the next question.
The phenotyping facility can be used for the real-time distribution of various minerals and biochemicals in the plant body.
Yes, there are like predictions that if you optimize hyperspectral imaging protocols, or even hyperspectral radiometric protocols, because it gives response of plants in terms of wavelength response in terms of spectral indices, lot many spectral indices. If you optimize that method, it is possible to look into some of the metabolites in plant tissues, and we can phenotype them.
How plant phenotypic plasticity index can be calculated?
For example, root plasticity, just we are talking, let us talk about.
Yes, yes.
So now what we expect is, if there is a normal condition, plant won't invest so much biomass in root. If there is like water stress, it starts sending its root deeper into the layers, deeper layers of the soil profile, I mean. So you want to capture that one. That's the question. If that is the question, it is possible to do it with phenotyping tools. There are like CT scan based phenotyping tools are available. It has been optimized. Even it shows how plant roots are interacting with the soil. That study also can be done.
Sorry, whether it is possible to phenotype during adverse environmental conditions, and if yes, how?
Yes, it is possible. It is possible. That's what like abiotic stress that we are talking about. And what do you mean like if there is a adverse weather condition, can you go for the plant phenotyping with all these tools? Is that the question?
Question is like that, whether in rainy seasons you can capture images or like that.
Because many of these sensors, they have electronic system. People won't prefer to do that one. They protect them, or some of them protected conditions, like if cameras are protected. In some cases, I have seen that one. They use that one.
Is there an availability of low cost sensors for this type of observations?
We have to strike a balance between precision and the cost. So costly instruments have been like developed to ensure the precision. They are in crores and all those things. We talk about the plant phenotyping platform. But if you have simple traits like leaf senescence, I think you can optimize some of the methods even with the simple camera. You can optimize the method for your condition, and you can go for phenotyping for that particular trait, like leaf senescence and all.
Is there possibility to use this type of facility for disease diagnosis or disease scouting, scoring purpose?
Yes, it has been demonstrated, particularly that RGB based tools with simple camera, they have shown it can be used. And as I said, spectral cameras, hyperspectral cameras, and even IR camera and NIR, high IR camera, and even NIR imaging system have been used to differentiate the normal and diseased plants and or the leaves or something like that. It has been demonstrated. It is possible to do it.
Any platform available with AI based facility in the phenotyping of plants?
With which facility? Because the connectivity.
Artificial intelligence, AI. Scientific.
No, I haven't seen so far. But what I have heard that people have developed some of the robots which can pick up the ripened fruits from orchard. So there some level of artificial intelligence has been employed. That's what I understand. And there are efforts to bring in AI in plant phenotyping also. And again, it depends on the requirement. What really we are going to phenotype? That's really very important.
Thank you, sir. Some students are asking about, is there any institute providing hands-on training about the phenotypic and phenomics techniques?
Yes, wherever there are plant phenotyping facilities, they have come forward, and we conducted a couple of training for scientists from India as well as from outside. So if students are interested in learning these techniques, they are most welcome to National Institute of Abiotic Stress Management. I am also the Indian Institute of Indian Agriculture Research Institute, IRI New Delhi, they are also conducting the training program.
How root structures can be analyzed without damage? The question. Actually, given some answers about that.
Yeah. There are two methods have been developed. I have seen there may be many more. They are very hi-fi methods. One is MRI method that I have shown you. Other one is like CT scan. That is CT tomography, what they say. So that allows us to see the root without disturbing the soil. See how potato can grow, how sugar beet grows. That can be studied from the point of initiation till it matures. It is possible to do that one. And in one of the UK lab and even in Ireland, they established a system to study the root and soil interaction and the root phenotyping in the medium throughput mode. That is something like 40 to 80 genotypes you can screen for root without disturbing the soil. And in addition to that one, I showed you a couple of technique how we can use the plant phenomics facilities of rice I have shown you, and there are many ways. Like if you pass through a transparent what you call a tube in the field, and then you like use some instrument like your scanner, it is possible to monitor the root growth right in the field condition itself. But it is very very tedious. One day someone will develop method for that also. That's what I feel. That is kind of a rhizotron.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for enlightening us on the phenomics, because the genomics is incomplete without proper phenotyping, and phenotyping is therefore very essential. So on behalf of all the participants and the Center for Advanced Agriculture Science and Technology for Climate Smart Agriculture and Water Management, I thank you very much. And for participants, there are so many questions being asked related to whether they can have training at Baramati or what are the tools that institute have. So I request all the participants to visit the website of the institute, and they so that they can understand or they can see what are the facilities are generated at the institute. It is one of the excellent facilities in terms of phenomics which we have in India. Sir, thank you very much for enlightening us on the plant phenomics. What are the what is the progress in terms of phenomics in India? What we can use or how we can use for different crops, and how we can best utilize it in delivering the products to the farming community. So once again, thank you very much for sparing time, particularly during the lockdown period. I know that you are stuck up in Pune. You could not even visit the institute because of the lockdown condition, but still you made it possible to deliver excellent lecture or presentation for the benefit of the participants. So at the peak of the time, we had more than 600 participants. And for participant, a link has been circulated in the group. So you are requested to fill up that information. That will be taken as your attendance. And also request you to join at 5 minutes before 4 p.m. For another excellent lecture by Dr. Amol Salunkhe. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Pawan. Thanks a lot. Thanks to all.